Right. So yeah, welcome everybody back to home. And actually, I think I saw Erica on there too. So welcome to home. Home is, well, I guess it's a little more metaphorical than it was, but Phuntsok for the past few years has been hosting these weekly meetings where we get to meditate and also dive into like what's going on in the world, in our personal lives, and get some wisdom from a Buddhist perspective. Phuntsok has been on that path for quite some time. He was a monk for quite some time, and we're always really grateful to hear his perspective on the myriad questions, ideas, and topics we can throw at him over the years. This week in particular, we're going to be diving into really that genuine difference in listening to someone, being mentored by someone, being guided by someone, and the, I would say that the sometimes difficult moments where our discernment, and what we're being told by that mentor aren't lining up. This was a topic that was requested by Cassandra. And Cassandra, if you wanted to say anything about like personally how that topic resonated for you or how it came to your mind, feel free to unmute yourself.
Yeah, sure. Thanks for doing this topic. I feel like, you know, we're all deep into spiritual practices, but anyone on at the beginning of their journey or not starting the spiritual path yet, they're probably confused by, you know, the term guru, and even though it just means teacher, it's kind of taken on this whole other term, I think, in some ways of worship. And and then it just brought me to this thought of how can we, you know, have love. I feel like I also just like gush easily for people that I love in my life, and have noticed sometimes that's a bit of an ego trip for people. It's like kind of a lot when it's coming from this nervous place. So, and of course that could happen in any type of relationship, whether that's a teacher or loved one, romantic, anything like that. So really excited to hear kind of, I think it's going to clear up all of these sort of sayings we've heard over our lifetime, like love is blind and, you know, all those sayings. So I'm really excited. Thank you for doing this one, Phuntsok.
Thank you.
Awesome. So like I said, we'll start off with a meditation led by Phuntsok, and then we'll dive into that topic. Phuntsok will give some commentary, a lecture, and then toward the end we'll have time for a couple questions, if there's anything that specifically stood out to you, and then we'll close and have a little closing meditation and dedication to wrap up the evening. So with all of that, I'll turn it over to Phuntsok, and please take it away.
Okay, thank you. All right. Welcome everyone. Tonight's topic is I think about the confusion that comes around when we seek to express love, especially towards someone that we admire. And we've witnessed perhaps how that can become, it seems like it's love that's continuing, but it's no longer love. It has transformed into something else, but it seems to have a continuous expression of love when it already has shifted into something else. That when it has shifted into something else, we're caught in what it was supposed to have been or what we thought it was in the beginning, and we don't know how to continue what we are presently experiencing. And sometimes we may not even be aware that that it has transformed into something else, and something that is, you could say, toxic for everyone involved, all the members involved in that relationship. We want to continue with the purity that we touched, and we want to no longer continue whatever it has transformed into, the toxic part that it has transformed into, the attachment, which can be expressed in so many different ways. I'm going to lead a meditation, or a very simple meditation, on just resting in a sense of wonder and staying in that and allowing yourself to relax and allowing yourself to go deeper just by directing attention more and more, more and more, more and more, holding attention in that experience that comes up, that sense of wonder. And without rejecting anything, without grasping onto anything. Right? I'm gonna put on figured out the new face of the app. Okay, so it won't take long. I always promise that, don't I? Okay. All right, make the intention that you're going to meditate. Communicate to all the parts of you that you are going to meditate. Allow the intelligence within the body to respond in its cooperative manner. Feel how the energy part of you, the emotional, all the different parts of you are responding to your intention to meditate. Allow them to participate. Allow their cooperation. Welcome their cooperation. And begin with a general sense of feeling the space around you. Without rejecting anything, without grasping onto anything. Just have a general sense of the space around you. You are training, you're accustoming the mind to just be with what is. In a sense, you're connecting with love. You are in the space that allows whatever is to just be. And without rejecting everything else that's around you, now bring awareness closer to the body and feel the body connected to your space. Feel the whatever movement that is around you, the temperature, if there is a breeze, if you're lucky. And especially the point of contact between your body and the ground, that very palpable contact. And we're not expecting it to be this way or that way. We are simply bringing attention to whatever data that we are receiving, just being present with what is. You may notice your mind going from this to that, even in the just the awareness of the point of contact. But don't worry about it. It shouldn't be here. It shouldn't be there. It shouldn't be in any way. Just the way it is, that's what it's supposed to be. Feeling that point of contact. feeling the ground holding and supporting you. And there is this deliberate, this conscious sense of, I can trust this. I can trust my body to be held. I can trust my body to be supported, because you're witnessing it being held, being supported. You're abiding in what is. Now deliberately, consciously, allow that to take place. Now surrender to the ground, let it hold your body. Have that attitude, have that sense. Okay, I release it, hold it for me. And by doing that, notice a kind of a pleasantness slowly arising, a kind of a calm slowly arising, palpably in the body. Now direct attention to that without rejecting other things. Just be more aware as much as you can of that nice, pleasant feeling slowly arising, that nice, that sense of calm. Connect with that sense of calm in the legs. Connect with that pleasantness and that sense of calm in the abdomen, from the hips all the way to the shoulders. Make palpable contact, palpable connection with it in whatever measure that it is present. Not wishing it for it to be stronger or lesser than what it is. We are simply being with it as it is. Now go to the shoulders and also let the shoulders go. Let them arrive at the evenness that they seek. Let the arms go, let the hands go, let the fingers go. Notice and make contact with the measure of calm and pleasantness present in there also. Now bring awareness to the head and neck. Rejoice as you make contact with the calm and the pleasantness there, allowing the head and neck to find its center. So there's no need to consciously hold them in place. With the head and neck centered, you may notice a slight enhancement in the calm and the pleasantness in the overall sense of the body. A kind of lightness. Mouth, teeth, tongue, bring awareness there. Be aware of their natural resting places. Understand this relaxation, this relaxing, this letting go, this allowing is permitting us, permitting awareness to dive into itself, to be aware of something that is always there, but for some reason escapes us. So we're letting go of what we are habitually aware of to allow for what is always there, but we're not aware of. Bring attention to the muscles of the face, the forehead. Make contact with the calm and the pleasantness there. To the eyes as they rest softly. And if you are continuing to simply allow, let go as you are scanning the body, by this time that you reached your eyes, you should notice a markedly enhanced experience of that calm and the pleasantness. Perhaps the inner sensations are already slowly arising if they're not present yet. Already pointing to the natural clarity and the radiance. And there might be some sort of an energetic general feeling that you feel. Consider that to be my meditative state, my meditative state, my meditative state. And as you reaffirm it, notice how it enhances and how more and more palpable that sense of it becomes. And the intelligence that is spontaneously manifesting. There's tension, of course, release it. There's tension here, I wasn't aware of it, of course, release it. And as you do so, notice that natural sense getting stronger, that I am indeed in meditative state. I'm going deeper into it. And let this be a conscious decision, a commitment, not an accident, but a commitment, a decision, a conscious decision to fully enter into this experience. And with that, take a full breath, deep breath in through the nose, out the mouth. Notice the sounds, notice the visions, notice the sensations. Notice that you've entered into a deeper sense of that calm and that pleasantness. And the sensations' strength are pointing to the natural clarity and radiance. And feel that sense of being in a meditation getting stronger and more of a sense of a prominent presence. Stay with awareness of it without rejecting anything, without grasping it. If you're feeling a sense of radiance, a sense of movement, almost like a rhythmic movement back and forth. That's your meditation. If you're hearing some sort of a sound that's taking you deeper into calm, deeper into pleasantness, deeper into peace, that's your meditation. If it's a warmth, if it's a heat, if it's a peace, whatever it is, that's your meditation. Stay with it. Gently raise your attention to the space in front of you at the level of your eyebrows. By merely doing that, notice the sensation in the forehead and immediately ascribe to that sensation, however, whatever the sensation is for you personally, the presence of my potential that guides me, that protects me. A sign of my natural ability to focus, direct, and hold my attention. And as you feel this general sense of being in a meditative state, this energetic feel, this sensorial sensation of being in meditation, of being in a different space, qualified mostly by a sense of calm, a pleasantness, qualified by a sense of clarity, radiance, a sense of calm. Stay in it, stabilize with threefold breath, just like before. And as you breathe out, let yourself go as deeply, just surrender to the experience. Let your attention be drawn deeper into it without rejecting. through the mouth, through the nose, breathe in, through the mouth, breathe out. 3 times. Stay where the out-breath takes you as you take the next inhalations. And with the last exhalation, as you exhale with the last exhalation, have the sense of diving. Releasing not only the breath, but releasing all artificial identifications, all artificial means of being, all the things that are not us that we are holding onto, letting them go. And just allow that journey to continue. And while in that state, have deep respect, deep trust and gratitude. Know that the joy we seek is already present. You can even say the reason we seek it is because somehow we were distracted from it. And it's calling us back to return to our natural joy. So whatever gives you the slightest taste of it, stay with it. Stay aware of it as you continue to relax. The love we seek, the compassion we seek, the knowing we seek, it is because we have become distracted from them. And it's that very disconnect that we feel, which is in a sense a calling to return. The compassion is already here. The love is already here. The knowing is already here. Whatever slightest taste we have pointing to it, go towards it. Let it take you. Into that vast knowing. Limitless, spontaneous compassion and love. That unconditional joy. So no need to imagine what that joy should be. No need to imagine what that love or that compassion or that knowing should be. There's a deep, deep sense within you that already knows. Trust that. And that taste, however slight that taste may be that you have, if it's just a pleasantness, just stay with it. Let yourself melt into it. How wonderful it would be if everyone was truly happy. Let yourself go into the emotion of that, the energy of that, the vision of that, the possibility of that, the wonder of that. Keep relaxing. Okay, get ready to come out of the meditation. And take a moment to notice the experience that you're having. How none of this experience is something that we created, but rather just found already present. In this way, we can trust that deeper instinct, that deeper sense of knowing there is even more that is already present. We simply have to allow ourselves to make contact with, to access. Get ready to come out of the meditation. Rejoice that witnessing yourself abiding in some measure in a meditative state. And with that, take a nice deep breath, feel and hear that breath. And slowly let yourself deliberately, consciously reconnect with your immediate surroundings. Connect with your sense of touch, sense of hearing, and sense of sight. All right, let me make sure that I will not be disturbed. Off. Okay, nice. Okay. Well, thank you very much for the topic for tonight. And don't worry about it, whether it's going to be relevant to what's going on in the world or not. I can tell you, not to be boastful in any way, but to understand that whatever we cover, no matter what the title of the topic that we cover, it's always relevant to what's happening. As a matter of fact, that's why this forum exists, to discuss things that are very relevant, always, all the time. No matter what is going on in the world, what we discuss here should always be relevant. And what's happening now, we can also, and it's very good when you attend a talk, when you attend a teaching, no matter how abstract the topic, the subject matter may be, always try to make an effort to see how it connects to what's going on, how it can be applied to what's going on in your life at the present moment. Otherwise, it's just useless information and something you just put on your shelf and you don't know when you're going to be able to make use of it. Okay. And to begin with what's going on, I want to, it's very sad, but at the same time, it's incredibly exciting and wonderful what's going on. To see that there's a recognition of something deep, something profound, something meaningful that we are all connected to, that is asking us to respond, asking us to pay attention to, within us, outside of us. It's asking us to, I will also say, to bring about meaningful dialogue, meaningful exchange, meaningful understanding, and to really let ourselves know that, hey, this is, this belief that I have is relevant, this belief that I have should be relevant, or this belief that I have, oh, it's completely irrelevant. And to be brave, to have courage, to let go of certain things that we hold dearly, and to see that, wait a minute, this belief, this thing I'm holding on to is not really helping me. It's not really helping me to fulfill what it's promising. And if we don't allow ourselves to directly see these things, no matter how unpleasant or pleasant it might be, then it's very difficult to move forward, very difficult to evolve, to continue to evolve. And this is something that is sort of driving, this is what is driving the world, this is what is driving especially humanity, is the topic of love. And I'm not talking about it in a sense of, in the poetic sense, and I'm not excluding the poetic sense of it. It is seeking it, thinking we have found it, that moves us, that makes us behave, that makes us relate, that makes us act towards and relate with one another, react or not react. It is our, how deep are we into love? And we want to be able to, we feel compelled to go as deeply into it as possible. We feel it calling us. And when we believe that we have found the conditions that allows us to let love free, so we can fully feel it, fully experience it, and we have certain experiences that seems to relate to having released love, having opened our heart. Some people might say having opened our hearts to love. And depending on the kind of reaction that we receive, it does determine how much of an opening we allow, we hold on to, and how much we allow ourselves to dive into love. The topic tonight is specifically about when love becomes toxic, almost, especially in relationship to someone or something that we admire. And what we admire could be, it could be a person, it could be an idea that we admire. And the reason that when and we have to go into why do we admire it? What in us makes us admire something, makes us admire a person, makes us admire an ideal? And what are we doing when we are admiring? What is going on? And I'm not going to go into the biology of it. I'm sure there's a biological component. Everything that's happening to us as its biological component or biological response or biological trigger, as to there is no chicken and the egg in this instance. There is no, in the realm of spirituality, there is no chicken and the egg, okay? It's not a matter of trying to figure out what came first or what came second, right? The thing is, it's a system of cooperation. I affect you, you affect me, and you affect me, I affect you, and trying to find out which what started it is an irrelevant question. Because when we're asking what started it, without knowing it, we're asking an absolute question without even knowing it. And absolute questions are the cause of every single kind of problem that we have. Because we think with absolute questions, we are expecting an absolute answer. And unfortunately, the universe cannot provide an absolute answer because such things do not exist. And we end up disappointing ourselves because expecting, wanting, waiting for an absolute answer. And when something presents itself as the absolute answer, then we end up finding later on and being completely disappointed, completely disillusioned, because it is not an absolute answer. There are relative answers, yes, there are relative answers. Between this time and that time, which came first? Well, between this time and that time, this came first. And that's it, this relativity. But to think that in an absolute sense, this came first, then we are deluding ourselves. There is no such thing. So the mind should not, when your mind is going towards absolutes, bring it back, take it back, because it's going on an endless adventure, not even adventure, but it's going on an endless journey towards further and deeper suffering. Okay. So what is happening in admiration, in admiring? What is the relative position of the things that we can point to that triggers at this relating with admiration? And the answer is somewhat connected to the term namaste. Okay. When we encounter an object, a person, an idea that strikes a chord deep within us, that it seems to be drawing on admiration, it's drawing upon us to admire it. What is happening is not the thing itself or the person itself that is doing that, but rather something that we've made contact with something ancient, something extremely personal. We make contact with something extremely intimate. But it's not in the person, it's not in the idea, but rather within us. You could say because of the conditional relationship that we have with that person or with that idea, and it could be any idea, it could be any person, but because of the conditional relationship that we establish with that person or that idea, that it acts as a mirror for us. That at that moment, it reflects something very, very ancient, something very, very dear, something very, very intimate. And that's what we are drawn to. That's what attracts us. So that's what we seek. That's what we feel rightfully to admire. And to put it in a very New Agey kind of sense, we have had a glimpse of our divine nature, reflected, mirrored to us through that person or through the idea. And through that person doesn't necessarily mean like a snapshot of that person, but rather it could be a range of things. It could be, remember, this is the realm of spirituality. There is no absolute, right? It could be mannerism of the person. It could be the walk of the person. It's a combination of things that points to something that mirrors to us a spark, to remind us of, in the Buddhist term, our Buddha nature. So our Buddha nature is somehow, we were given a glimpse of it. And of course, something as precious, something as incredibly rare and magnificent as our Buddha nature, to be given a glimpse of it, we should be grateful through the avenue, through the means, through the medium through which we were given that access, we were given that taste. And that's what begins that's what begins the process of admiration. I am very, very, it's a kind of a gratitude. I'm very grateful to you because you have pointed to something that I've been seeking almost for as long as I can remember, or even that I've been seeking even unconsciously. I wasn't even aware that I was seeking this, and yet here I have found it. Or I was consciously seeking for it in frustration and almost to the point of becoming discouraged, and yet here is a glimpse of it. And in wanting to stay connected with that glimpse, in wanting to stay connected with that taste, unfortunately, we do not have the full wisdom to be able to do this in a way that is skillful. So the only thing that we can do is to, because of our conditioning, because of what we have conditioned ourselves to do in relationship to anything connected to that, when we see something that we like, we admire, something that gives us a glimpse of our innate joy, the only habit that we remember is attachment. So that habit just naturally just come up. Hey, you found something you like? Okay, the way to make sure that you maintain a connection to it is to be attached. And attachment manifests in so many different ways. What attachment is promising us, it's promising us a continued connection to that experience. But unfortunately, attachment cannot deliver that. As a matter of fact, what attachment is asking us to grab a hold onto is already gone. What attachment is asking us to grab a hold onto, what that is, the thing that, or the event, the reality that we believe that we are holding onto, what we believe is the source, is the joy, is the divine spark. What we are holding onto is more of a memory. And that's where the idea of the pedestal comes up. So it's like you go somewhere, you grab a trinket and you put it on your mantle. Okay. And the reason for the trinket is because it reminds you of whatever experience you've had with that with that trinket. So what we are grasping onto are the things that is the things that we've made the association with, that mirroring, that is the personality, the form of the idea rather than the idea itself, the spark that was ignited within us. We are no longer, it's like it was just a spark, it happened. It's not something that is sustained, right? So rather than going back to that spark, rather than going back to that glimpse, to that taste, we are holding on to the medium through which we acquired that taste. And we make the medium of that taste to be, now we equate it with that taste itself. It is not the taste. It was simply a mirror, and because of conditions that mirrored our Buddha nature, that mirrored our enlightened nature. And we equate that experience of that of that taste with the object that we made contact with. And when we do that, we are putting the person on the pedestal. But there is a way of doing this without damaging ourselves. If we continuously understand that what is going on, that through this, I am able to make contact. Through this, I'm able to have a taste, an experience of something profound. And because of that, I respect this medium. And we love this medium. We love this means through which we make that contact in a sense of gratitude. Thank you for allowing the condition for you to mirror for me what is profoundly important to me. And I'm grateful to you. But not that the taste, the very thing that we tasted is the medium. Equating the taste with the medium is where we are making a mistake, where our love is becoming attachment. And this admiration, this appreciation of that glimpse of that taste is now transformed into what is referred to as a personality worship, okay? Or putting somebody on a pedestal. And the danger of that, and we all know the danger of that, is that if we indeed equate the means, the medium, with the actual experience, since they're not the same, and we are going to directly perceive this medium transform, we are going to directly see this medium display behaviors, display attributes, completely disconnected with the spark. And because we made the equation, then we're going to think that either the spark is not worth pursuing, or we completely dismiss the role of the medium. That we now the respect that we started to develop for that medium, for having made that, helping us to make that contact, make that connection. Now we throw that respect, out. And because we are equating the experience with the actual spark, what we are doing, we are turning away from that spark. We are turning away from the spark. We are turning away from establishing further the condition for us to continue to make, to encounter the spark, to encounter this taste of our true nature, of that with that joy, that spontaneous compassion that we seek. Okay. So what should we do when we encounter such, when we have such an encounter? The main thing to maintain is a sense of gratitude. A gratitude that through this interaction, interrelating with this person, and we were able to make that, we were able to have that taste. And we are grateful for that. Because we cannot deny the taste, we cannot deny the experience. It's something that is cannot be denied. Okay, so we are grateful for that. Continue to maintain that gratitude. And perhaps this person or this idea may continue to connect us deeper and deeper, until we recognize. Until at some point we are able to no longer need this intermediary, so to speak. We're able to make direct contact ourselves. And this direct contact will manifest in different ways. By direct contact, I'm not saying that you no longer have to relate with this person whatsoever or relate with this idea whatsoever. But it could be in such a way that I would say this way, the personality of the person, if we talk about a person here, okay, let's stick with the person. The personality of that person is no longer relevant at all. That whenever you're interacting with this person, the personality just goes away and only the divine spark remains. Only that. So they become just pure mirror, pure reflection. And they behave that way. They relate to you in that way because you understood that is what from the very beginning, that's what you are making contact with. Because the physical body will pass away. Okay. If that is indeed the source of that which you cherish, then when the body passes away, then there goes there goes whatever it is that you cherish, then forget about it. Okay, there's no more further cultivation to do. But if you understand that this was just a means for that connection, then you can love the person because of that relationship that you have with them, because it's a precious relationship. You can admire with the spark that is awakened within you, that is, or not awakened necessarily, but the taste of that Buddha nature, that awakening nature that you have made some sense of contact with. You can admire that. You can continue to admire that. But it's not that you're admiring yourself, because our idea of who we are right now that we call ourselves is completely messed up. Okay, but rather that spark, that divine, that awakening, that potential within that we've had a taste of. And the taste could be in so many different kind of degrees. It could be just some kind of conviction that you cannot shake. Not necessarily a blissful experience, not necessarily a sense of knowing, a sense of vastness, or any of these things. It could be just a measure of conviction of something deep, something profound, and you cannot shake off, you cannot shake that conviction. And that conviction seems to rise within you, seems to come up within you, in your heart, in relationship to that person. Okay, so you admire that relationship. You love the person. And remember what we started to mention before, you love the person, that is, you make space to accept the person, to accept the total personality of the person. And if there are, there are certain aspects of the personality that needs improvement, so you make space for that. Or also, the thing is to continue to stay connected to the deeper aspect. Stay connected with that deepest aspect. Okay. And by doing that, you're helping yourself return to your original nature, to your enlightened nature. And by relating properly in this way, and whatever defaults, whatever faults may have been in that person, you are in turn helping the other one also, okay? But don't think that, hey, I am helping you, and that's the contract. But rather, don't focus on you helping, okay? But rather focus on that you are being helped. And just without having to state it, understand that the personality through which you're relating with this person, that personality is also being helped by making themselves available, making themselves, allowing the condition for them to be the mirror for you to encounter, for you to witness your divine spark. All right. Wow. I've never left a lot of time for questions. This time I thought I would stop here and then allow for questions and comments also. Okay. And if you want to even bring up certain things. Okay, hot topics. Okay, all right. Especially within the Tibetan tradition. I wouldn't say especially within the Tibetan tradition. I'm talking about as a culture in the Eastern tradition, right? The way of relating to teacher is more reverence than respect, right? In the Western tradition, the term reverence is usually to sort of bring those two to a common ground of understanding, common ground of experience, but using different, perhaps, vocabulary, right, for the same experiences. Never mind the relative meaning of those different terms, right? From the Western perspective, the term reverence is not to be directed towards anything other than just purely the divine, right? And not even that through which the divine may directly manifest, all right? From the Eastern tradition, the teacher is considered to be the divine incarnate, the divine taking personal interest in your life and then guiding you personally. And it comes from that tradition where the idea of worshiping the guru comes in, okay? But fortunately for us, first we have to establish a relationship where we actually experience being touched, being connected to the divine through whoever, before we can say, the divine is working through you for me. And I completely negate your appearance, the appearance that is subject to death, subject to impermanence. I completely negate that. And I'm just going to relate only to the divine that I'm connected to through you. So even though it looks like I'm worshiping you, but I'm not worshiping you. I'm worshiping the divine. I'm doing namaste. I'm worshiping the divine. It's just that I'm able, it's like you are the phone number for me to make that connection. And when I'm addressing you, when I'm directing myself to you, I'm...
I hope you can continue to hear me. Can you continue to hear me?
Yes, it just got a little quieter.
Okay, because it switched to the battery ran out. Okay, I have to put my face a bit closer to the screen so you can hear me. Can you hear me? Okay, good. The practice of negating the personality, negating that the part of the person that you are dealing with, and rather continuously to relate with the divine that you have made a contact with, okay? That's the thing. You must have made contact with the divine. There must have been something in that relationship, in that person, that mirrored the divine for you. And if you can continue to stay in contact with that, then when you're worshiping, when you're pedalizing, you're not directing it towards a person. As a matter of fact, if you notice the person becoming, their ego is becoming inflated because they believe that this reverence is towards them rather than to the divine, to the spark within them, then you must in some way or another uh, uh, use skillful means without disturbing your relationship. Use some skillful means so that their ego is not damaged, is not inflated because of what you're doing. Okay, you understand? So basically, as a student, when you see your teacher ego is becoming inflated, you could say that very divine spark within you is showing you that. And your reaction shouldn't be, it's not to damage that relationship, but rather to help the personality. And if the personality is no longer making itself, a viable path, a viable medium to make that connection, because the personality, the ego is becoming so inflated, it's now veiling the divine spark that you were able to make contact with. Then be very grateful for what has happened before up to this moment. And if continuing forward, your divine spark that you make contact with is becoming more and more veiled, then it's time to look for a different medium to mirror that divine spark for you. Okay. And it's not by completely abandoning the person, but understanding that, to put it in a very cowardly way, the karma right now. The karma that allows you to have that beautiful relationship went out. Okay, that's the cowardly way of saying it. I'm not afraid to say it. I'm not afraid to be a coward. Okay. So the karma went out. So without, tossing him aside, you were never that, because it was that for you for that moment, for that time. Okay. It could be that the potential you had for this person to continue to be that way for you wasn't for the rest of your life, okay? Then maybe that person either has to go to some deeper transformation, and you have to, maybe it's time for you to grow. And this is not the way for you to grow anymore, and you move somewhere else. And the whole point is not necessarily to look for someone, but rather to continue to seek that divine connection with that divine spark. Continue to seek a direct experience, a direct taste of your enlightened potential, okay? And it may come through you again, through another person, or through an idea, or through some kind of experience. Again, that experience, that event, that person, again, they're just a means for you to make contact. Okay. So this is to almost like say, yes, worship, but understand what you are doing and why you're doing it. And understand that the worship is not directed towards the personality, even though from the outside it may seem that way. But in your mind, understand what you are worshiping, what the emotion of worshiping is directed towards. But when the worship is misguided, then it becomes pedestaling. I don't know if that word if that's a word or not. We just made it up. Yeah, okay, all right. But you understood. That's the important things of language, that you communicate something and then you understand it. And that's where we're in danger of attachment. And attachment is opposite of love, okay? What it does, it wants to hold on to something that cannot be held on to. Love has to be spacious. It has to allow. That's what it is. And because it resonates, it corresponds to the nature of things, that they are spacious. They're always in flux, always moving. So there's nothing that we can actually grab onto. Okay. So attachment is trying to grab onto something that cannot be grasped. And because it's an effort that is doomed to failure. And that's where suffering comes in. Attachment always leads to suffering because attachment cannot fulfill what it's promising. It cannot give you what it's promising you. The very act of attachment is doing a complete opposite of what it's promising you. All right. I interrupted myself and so anybody have any questions, statements?
I have a question. Hi. I guess it's about the responsiveness to, like, when you have an attraction to a person, place, or thing, and or you don't feel attached, but it keeps rising up. It keeps rising up either through your visual, the vista of your mind. And it feels like a clue. And it's almost like it's just such an interesting wonderment. And the wonderment of, oh, look at this rising up all the time, feels like a really good opportunity for storytelling to occur in the mind, because that's such a phenomena. I'm always bumping into this person, keeps mm-hmm. rising up. And there is a wanting to do something. So I guess my question is, it's far enough, like, you know, in your meditation, you kind of can see the agitation coming. Mm-hmm. You're not already devoured by it, but like you get to a point where you're like, oh, it's coming closer. And that's how I feel. That's not the question. My question is, I guess is the like, I have enough distance to choose because it's not right in my face. Can you tell I'm talking about something personal? My point is, yeah, there's a lot of space because that's how my mind sees it. So I don't move, I don't act, but it just curiously comes up over and over again. Mm-hmm. What do I do? I apologize, everybody. That was not a deep question. I guess it's maybe you can take it almost like is it the same thing as meditation? Like, what do we do with the things that stimulate us? And do, you know, should we? I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Apply what I said about the personality, the teacher, with everything that we admire. Even a piece of art, for example, right? There is something about it that strikes us, something about it that draws something, some wonderment within us. So it's not necessarily, it's not to completely dismiss the piece of art and say, well, it has nothing to do with it whatsoever. But it is because of encountering it, we are encountering this experience, right? But the experience is not the art, but we have to respect the art for the encounter, for the experience. So this person that keeps coming up, and it's because we feel connected to something deep because of that. And it's not necessarily enough for us to go back home and just remember the art for that experience to be relived. We have to go back and encounter the art again so we can make that contact. But the main thing to remember is that, yes, there is this period of time when there is the need for a direct contact, direct encounter with the means, but understand it to be a means and love it and admire, love it for providing that experience within us. But it's the danger is equating the experience with that which we encounter. That's what a danger is. That's the only thing. It doesn't mean that, well, you're not this thing that I'm, the art is not the experience. I don't need the art. The art is helping, is doing something. So we should be grateful to it and appreciate it.
So I should call him.
Yeah.
I love you.
Okay. I have a question if we have a moment for it. What can we do to expand our feeling of admiration, either like in the depth of the experience with that one person or more generally, more broadly? How can we have more admiration?
Very nice question. Because I can completely sidetrack with your question. So thank you for giving permission to do that. All right. And it will be answering the question, by the way. Remember the very first line of the Dhammapada. It's a very profound teaching. The first line, without going to quoting it verbatim, but to sort of give a general sense of what the first line of the Dhammapada is referring to, the first verse, the first and second verse. What it's essentially saying is the world that we encounter, me, the world, you know, this kind of dynamic, it is a mutual thing. It is a mutual thing in a sense that the attitude that I hold determines how the world seems to behave towards me. And when the world behaves towards me in such a way that seems to support my ideas of it, then it perpetuates it. It perpetuates it. So if I am holding the world, if I'm holding an idea in reference to the world, where the world is giving me bad experiences, then if I continue to perpetuate those ideas, then the world will continue to behave that way. And by me continuing to behave that way, the world will continue to behave towards me that way. And the world can also shift, and my attitude towards it can also shift. Okay. And the thing is, the dynamic between the experiences of the experience, the way the world is acting towards me, the way the world is behaving, the way the world is appearing toward me, my attitudes that I hold, they are affecting each other. Now, you encounter an experience where there is indeed this connection with this divine within you through this person. And it is this attitude, holding this attitude in your mind, that it is not the color, it's not the shape, it's not the personality, it's not any of one of those things that is the absolute cause of this thing that is arising within me, that I want to continue to arise within me. But relating towards those composite things with a sense of gratitude for having helped me make that connection, that's the attitude that will continue to help the admiration to grow and for you to continue to see things for you to be able to admire. Direct your attention. There are so many things that we can direct our attention to hold our attention on. on, and that will determine the experience, right? And those things are, they can be selected. They're not forced to do them. Look at the person and continue to see the things that spark, continue to encounter, continue to perceive those qualities, those attributes that help to trigger that. Continue to direct your attention towards them. And that they will sort of create a sort of a ricochet kind of dynamic where it will continue to make you admire, and you will continue to admire, and you will continue, and this will grow. Okay. Or it could be, and it could be, if you decide rather to look at things that do not spark admiration, do not spark this feeling, then the sense of admiration, the sense of that connection, it can completely go away. And a direct example is one of the disciples of the Buddha, forgot his name, who kept looking at not the great things that the Buddha was doing, but rather kept looking at tiny little things. Oh, look at that, he left a grain of rice. Look at that, he took off his shoes 2 seconds before he, whatever. That was a criticism in his mind. So because of that, he couldn't see what others were seeing and experiencing from the Buddha. Eventually he left the Buddha because that guy, there was nothing extraordinary about him. Okay. Just for the sake of making the story, there's a funny ending to it. The funny ending to it is that after leaving the Buddha, and then he was he started to follow somebody else. And he was complaining. And one of the disciples of the Buddha passed by and was complaining. And well, the Buddha found out, he and the Buddha came to meet again. And he was complaining with the Buddha. And the Buddha said, "Friend, did I ever tell you to leave everything behind and come follow me, and I will perform things for you so you can be marveled?" He said, "No." "Then why are you expecting me to do marvelous things for you?" Oh, that was supposed to be funny. the point of that story is, other than not being funny, point of the story is, what you perceive, and it's the thing, sort of like the mantra I've been repeating lately, what you perceive is not forced upon you. You can be selective about what you perceive, and what you perceive can affect your experience. And the experience of, I'm connected through something wonderful here. And you continue to perceive, make yourself perceive the things that encourages that experience. Then that, and they will affect each other, where the perception will, the perceiving of it will enhance it, and the enhancement of it will enhance the experience within you. Okay. So how do you, and the digression that I was gonna go into is this, and this is actually an exercise, and I think that we need to do, right? The images, especially the images of people that we have been conditioned to say, oh, that's not attractive. When you see that, just tell yourself, oh, wow, how beautiful that is, okay? And do that for a while and see what happens to you. You will begin to perceive those very same things that you thought were unattractive to be, wow, that's attractive, because that's, we forget that we are conditioned to say that's beautiful, that's not beautiful. We think it's, oh, that's because it's beautiful, I'm perceiving it. that's not beautiful. That's what I'm perceiving. But it's actually a mutual thing. Mutual thing in the sense that A, those attributes equal this. A, those attributes equal that. And it can reverse. It can reverse in the sense where imagine everywhere you look, say, oh, wow, how beautiful. Wow, how beautiful. Wow, how beautiful, right? Every encounter, almost like not blindly going silver lining and then getting everybody into trouble because of your neglect of things that are going on, but rather, let's say what's going on, for example, somebody could say, oh my God, that's awful. It's awful, it's awful. That is, they're looking at things that makes them able to say that. But at the same time, you can look and say, wow, people are waking up. People are saying, this generation doesn't want to these things that have been sort of hidden and not talked about to continue in the next generation. And they're saying we are fed up with it. Isn't that beautiful? Some people can say, that's what I'm seeing. And that's what they will encourage. And that's what they will perpetuate to see. But if others just see, oh my God, look at the destruction, or this is sad, that's all they allow themselves to see, and that's all they will experience. That's the digression I wanted to make with your question. So what you see determines what you experience, and what you see, you're allowed, you can select what you see. Thank you.
Can I ask almost a corollary to Emmett's question?
Yes.
Because as you said in the beginning, attachment is kind of such a deep habit, comes so quickly and easily to us. What are the ways to work with attachment when we notice that that's happening in that kind of a dynamic? Mm-hmm. And maybe some of what you said is like accentuating the admiration, but is there also something else around the attachment?
Oh yeah. This is an attitude to have, a kind of a mental cultivation. I would call it, some few generations ago, the way to raise a child is to make sure what's called a spare the rod and what's that, how's that go? Spare the rod and
spare the rod and hate the child.
Yes, yes. And now that we are growing up a bit more, we are becoming more mature. We are saying that's not how we should move forward, right? Instead, we are focusing on positive things to actually achieve the result that was being sought by that method. Okay, so the reason I'm using that example is to understand the habit of attachment is the mind sort of like using an antiquated means to achieve a certain aim. If we relate with the mind with that understanding, in a sense of the mind, the tendency for the mind to be attached, it's not that the mind is seeking what is actually the result of attachment. It's seeking something else. It's just that it's going about it in a wrong way. Okay, it's going about it in the wrong way. So when you find yourself having attachment, then one thing is to know that I admire something here. What is it that I'm admiring? And there's nothing wrong with admiring something. It's just that the reason that it's now attachment is because somehow I'm grasping. Somehow I am not allowing space for that thing to just be, but I want it to continue to stay the way I first encountered it. Okay. All right. So there's nothing wrong with continuing to want that experience, but those components that were there for that experience to come up, they cannot continue. And trying to make those same conditions continue, the same components to be present, that is attachment. So redirect the mind towards what it really wants. remind the mind, this is what you really want. It's not, this attachment is not what you want. This is what you want. And there it is, go in that direction instead, right? It's like understanding that a child wants joy and the child plays with something that is dangerous. The thing is, it's not, if you if you don't use the situation, if you're not skillful in this situation, it may make the child think that seeking joy, there's something wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with seeking joy. It's just that, the joy you want, okay, this is the way, this is how you get it. Go in this direction instead. Okay. So tell the mind, redirect the mind. I hope that answered the question.
Thank you.
Woo, it is hot out here. Okay. Anybody has ACs on already? Probably have ACs already back in the other coast. Yeah, we are toughing it out. No AC yet. Okay.
All right. Hi. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I hear you fine.
Okay. Well, I have some very, very juvenile thoughts I wanted to share and try to shed light on. So something that I constantly run into is this, is an issue that probably, that has less to do with the teacher and more about myself. But I often find myself sometimes feeling like so paralyzed to approach teachers because I don't feel that I've lived up to a certain standard or lived up to my own impossible expectations. And it, comes from such a self-critical place of feeling unworthy of seeking someone's attention. Mm-hmm. And there's another situation which I think parallels with this so much and in just a more mundane way is, so I have a really incredible therapist that I've been working with for 2 years. And it's such a wonderful blessing that a year and a half into working together, I find out that she's also a Dharma practitioner and it's really enhanced our work together. And even though I don't consider her to be a teacher, but I guess in some ways, a therapist can be considered that in some ways. But recently I found in our work that we're hitting a plateau or a blockage where I'm just kind of stuck. And so when my therapist starts suggesting the possibility that, maybe I need to explore a different modality or a different therapist, it brings up such a feeling of like fear of abandonment. And like shame for not having, been able to progress a certain way. And so it really brings up this thought of, well, if you give up on me, then I must really be hopeless.
Yeah, that is, quite deep.
I just wanted to add, so even though this is about a therapist, I think it could also totally apply to a spiritual teacher.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And this can also apply in many kinds of close, intimate relationships. And the thing is, these dynamics will play out in every relationship that we have. Okay. The way we were conditioned to relate will not just automatically go away. And what to remember is, when you're consciously entering into a relationship, the habitual patterns will play out, will be there, will be present. And when you are entering into those kinds of conscious decisions of intimacy, whether it's with a teacher, whether it's romantic or whatever it may be, or just a friend, the thing is to remember what you are making contact with from the deep place within you is not the object, it's not the person per se, okay? And what we have to remember is not to equate what is arising within us with the object that we are encountering. Whether doesn't matter. Well, I guess in the beginning there is this wonderful experience, and you want it to continue. And the danger is equating the person with the experience. And later on, depending on the relationship that you have, some painful things may also come up. Right? And in the same way, is to don't equate it with the object. But rather, there is something, there's a conditioning within us that is manifesting. And that's what we are encountering. We are encountering our conditioning. The sense of perhaps being abandoned, the possibility of it, if that is an issue that one is struggling with in a relationship, that issue will constantly be there. And we may have, and because it's constantly being there, just like by directing our attention to perceive the things that will nurture the sense of admiration to continue, unconsciously, we will make ourselves perceive things that will make us eventually be abandoned, because we accept that that's what I am worthy of. I'm worthy of being abandoned. And it's not necessary, and of course, it's not something that we hold at the conscious level of our mind. It's just the conditioning that we have that is driving us at an unconscious level. And it through that, we are making ourselves perceive the things that will eventually make us experience being abandoned. Understand that this is happening automatically. If indeed you experience abandonment, again, don't consider it to be, this is my nature, that you're encountering proof for your nature, but rather this conditioning is continuously to be played out. And just the same advice, try to make yourself perceive the things that will not make you experience abandonment. And one of them is the attitude of mind is that, yes, I may have been abandoned in the past, but that's the past, that's not my nature. And you may not, of course, it's not gonna come automatically that you stop, you abandon it altogether, even on an unconscious level, that my identity is not someone to be abandoned, even though that may not happen. But you'll work at it slowly and slowly by looking at the experiences in your life that undermines that. Look, I was not abandoned here. Look, I was not abandoned there. Look, I was not abandoned here. And that will make you start to see, that is not my nature. My nature is not that which is to be abandoned. Because you're seeing the opposite of the things that would make that conclusion. And because of that, you will begin to connect within yourself with those things that will make you not have to experience that anywhere. And I wish I could just say some magic things, a magic word, and say, see, now it goes away. But it's best to understand that it's a conditioning that's going to be with you for a while. Even though it's a lie, even though it's not true, but you will continue to experience for a while. But do not take it as your identity. This is not you. It's just a conditioning. And because it is a conditioning, you can condition yourself not to experience it. Even if it appears to happen, but you will not say, I was abandoned. Okay? The relationship ended. That's all that happened. It wasn't that I was abandoned. The relationship ended. Okay? All right. And many of us probably have this kind of, have this to some degree or another because of some kind of conditioning. Let's see.
Thank you for asking that question.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So it's that time. Any other questions? Anything to say, Isaac?
Hi.
Hi, yes.
Hi, I just want to say that it's so important to remember too for me, and just hearing you say it, like, you know, yes, the relationship has ended, but also like the spark is still there, you know, because that spark is in you, and that is just makes me really happy, because I think often for me, like, if a relationship ends, or, you know, you move on from something that brought you so much joy and love, and it's nice to remember what you said in the beginning, that it's really not namaste, and it's like in me, and just because I'm not connecting it with it right now, and that relationship has ended, but the capacity to have that is still in me, I just, you know, will find it somewhere else.
Oh, very good. Thank you. Yes. Thanks for reminding us that. You know, okay, this is a very superficial way of having an experience of attachment. You know, there's a pair of shoes that I've had for, I don't know for how long I've had it. And I keep repairing it. Even though when I take it to be repaired, the guy tells me, why don't you throw these away already? It's because I'm convinced the wonderful experience that I have is in those shoes. Okay. When I realize that it's not in those shoes, then I can let the shoe rest in peace. Okay. And allow for that relationship to flow to another pair of shoes. Okay. All right. Okay, ready to put in to last meditation, closing meditation. Somebody was going to say something, sorry. Okay, all right. So remember where you reached in the meditation, and by the mere recalling of the experience, allow yourself to taste it again. So the posture, being comfortable and at ease, is not the experience, but through it, we'll experience it. As we recall, the body felt this way. My breath was this way. My mind was this way. We begin to re-experience, begin to re-taste. And let us stabilize it with one full breath, deep and relax. Through the nose, breathe in, through the mouth, breathe out. There was a second, perhaps, a moment of a glimpse of having touched something profound that lasted less than a millisecond, perhaps. But it's an experience that we cannot deny. So with that understanding, relax so that experience can resurface, that experience can stay a bit longer. And as soon as you touch it, go into that sense of wonderment. Ah, how wonderful it would be if everyone was found true happiness. And stay in that wonder, the emotion of it, the feel of it, the energy of it. And keep letting yourself dissolve into it, the joy of it. And through invoking that sense of wonder, let the wishing go away and just stay in that sense, in that feel of it, however it is. Let yourself continue to meld into it. This peace, this joy that we are having a subjective experience of, we wish for it to have not just in a subjective aspect, but also to have an objective expression also. So tasting that, dedicate. Gyo wa di yi kyo kun
Sunam Yeshe Tsunzok Shin Sunam Yeshe Vichun We Damba Kuni Topar Show. Form that intention, that intention for this subjective experience to also have an objective expression through your mannerism, through the way you relate with others in the world. Let there be an objective expression of it also, this peace, this joy. With that, now make the intention to come out of the meditation through the nose, a nice deep breath, feel it and hear it, and out through the mouth. And with that, deliberately, consciously, bring consciousness to your immediate surroundings, your sense of touch, feel the temperature again, sorry, feel the clothing on you, hear the different sounds, and let your eyes take in light again. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Phuntsok. For everybody, this talk is recorded and it will be up on Phuntsok's Patreon page tomorrow morning. It's patreon.com/dooptenphuntsok. I forgot to copy it into the chat, so you can search it on there. If you're able to support and make a donation through the Patreon, it's always really appreciated. We get to keep these classes going and keep learning from Phuntsok. So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.